the song that you can't refuse. Massive Radio is the one you'll choose. So don't confuse. Cold cut solid steel. Yes.
Now we're back over to Richard James, our guest on today's programme. Richard, we seem to be playing your music almost every week, and the thing that I was most struck by is your extraordinary prolificness. I mean, you seem to be working all the time, is that right?
Yeah, every day.
And how many... Do you finish a track every single day, then?
I used to, but now I take more time with tracks these days, so it usually takes 2 or 3 days currently, I think.
And have you always got a project in mind? Are you writing for an album, or are they just things that you really want to get out of your system?
No, I just write music and sort of experiment sort of all the time, and then think about making albums and singles later to earn my living.
And actually, I've read quite a bit about you making your own instruments. Is that true?
Yeah, and I keep all that in my parents' house in Wales.
So when you... I mean, how often do you record with the instruments that you've made yourself?
Well, what I tend to do is sort of go and take samples and record lots of little bits that'll last me for the sort of next sort of 4 months kind of thing, and then come to London and use it all.
So why did you just decide in the first place to build your own equipment? What was wrong with the stuff you bought in shops?
I didn't have any money to start off with. That was why I started to make it, basically.
Did you also feel that the sounds that shop-bought equipment made weren't so interesting?
Yeah, well, that sort of came later, really, because once I'd had the money to buy shop equipment kind of thing, you know, I'd already learned how to build instruments, so it's kind of used it to my advantage.
So do you not use any conventional equipment at all in your studio when you're making records?
Yeah, I use things like computers and, you know, for sequencing and things like that.
But you don't use any conventional synthesizers?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
The secret's out.
Thank you.
you start from in terms of the style of music that you wanted to make? I mean, you've been associated a lot recently with this catch-all term ambient, but where did you start off from?
Just from a sort of sonic sort of experimentation sort of point of view. I was just really interested in sort of piecing sounds together and making little rhythms and things like that. I think that's the sort of first angle that sort of got me interested in it.
And was this based on anything you'd heard by other groups?
No. I just always liked creating stuff, you know, just making stupid tracks on tapes kind of thing when I was little, and just used to enjoy it, actually.
Thank you.
quite a lot has been made recently of your sort of interest in the modern classical world. The Music Machine got Karlheinz Stockhausen to listen to some of your music. Are you actually interested in contemporary classical music?
Yeah, and that was really wicked. I really enjoyed that. I'm a sort of big fan of scraping music.
So what about the business with Stockhausen recently? What did you make of all that?
Well, I was just sort of game to sort of, I don't know what the sort of programme was, you know, what they wanted to do kind of thing, but I was sort of, you know, into it.
I suppose the idea was that lots of people like yourself name check people like Stockhausen and contemporary classical composers, and they wanted to see what people like Stockhausen thought of it. And do you actually know what he thought of your work?
Yeah, I sort of heard a few comments and stuff, which are sort of quite funny, but sort of, you know, it's a bit disappointing because I sort of could have predicted what he said anyway, kind of thing.
What did he say?
You know, just sort of, you know, sort of arrogant attitude kind of thing. It's just what I probably thought he'd say.
You boys don't listen to me carefully enough, then.
Yeah. Because I think they were trying to make out it was, you know, the world of techno being influenced by Stockhausen, and I don't think it has at all, because I don't reckon 99% of sort of techno bods have, you know, will have ever heard of him, so.
It seems to me the only similarity is it's electronic, and it sort of ends there.
Yeah, it's just like a parallel sort of bit of world, really, and I don't think it really anything to do with techno.
The interesting thing is, though, that the people who listen to your kind of music are now starting to listen to Sennacherib and Stockhausen, so that's really the overlap. I think it's the interesting on the part of the audience.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, they're both sort of sonically interesting, I suppose, so, you know, that's the sort of common ground for me, anyway.
When you listen to things like that, do you put them in a historical perspective? Do you think of how, I wonder how he did that.
Yeah, but there's, it reminded me a bit of Forbidden Planet a little bit. That was done in the 50s, and that's better than that, I think, for sort of electronic-y type stuff.
What's Forbidden Planet? We'll be right back. Were you surprised by how much your music and your sound has taken off? I mean, you remixed one of your tracks with Philip Glass recently. I mean, that must be something of an accolade for you.
Yeah, sort of 50% of me sort of surprised, and the other 50% think it's normal kind of thing.
How did it work, the thing you did with Philip Glass?
Just got in touch with him and thought, you know, see if he was into orchestrating one of my tracks. And he sort of sent back a demo, which I thought was rubbish. And, you know, I said I didn't like it and stuff. And he was seemed to be quite offended and sort of went away and did something else. And I thought that was really good. And I sort of ended up going over and finishing it off with him. You know, I was just ended up telling them how I wanted them to play things and stuff.
Because presumably most of the time, if not all the time in the past, you've been working on your own. So this was the first time you actually had to go out there and...
Yeah, I mean, usually I just, you know, if I want to change something, I'll just twiddle a knob or press a button. So it's quite weird, you know, to have to talk to people.
Richard, do you recognise any of the sounds in that?
Yeah, cheeky underground resistance, a bit of acid.
And what did you think of the whole thing?
Yeah, it's alright actually, yeah.
Improvisation. I know you play live. Do you improvise any of your stuff?
Yeah, it's split into about half at the moment. Going to a studio, just mucking about and not really knowing what I'm going to come out with. And the other half is sort of knowing exactly what I'm going to do, sort of song and stuff.
James, does jazz hold any interest for you?
Oh yeah, it doesn't really sound like jazz for me. That sounds more like rock.
Did it? But,
yeah, it's alright. I'd get into it if I was drunk.
What about soundtracks? Are you interested in doing those?
Yeah, I've sort of had a few and done a few things, but they've all been turned down. It's pretty difficult to write for Hollywood, really, if you've got a sort of no-compromise kind of attitude.
And you've kept that attitude when you've been working on big films, have you?
Yeah, and it's really difficult. They just treat you like a total sort of object kind of thing, and it's very difficult to sort of work to their sort of standards kind of thing.
We'll be right back.
so peaceful, but I know that after a while it just, that wears a bit thin and you just get really bored and want to go and buy some records and go out and stuff.
How did you start doing what you do here, if you see what I mean? I mean, what was it that was going on locally that inspired you to take up?
Nothing, basically. That's what made me do music, I think. Just because there's nothing else.
Yeah.
I mean, there is some music scene, but it's nothing that I was interested in. But it's just out of boredom, really, which is the best way to do music, I think, when you've got nothing else to do. So.
sounds, almost sounds taken to the point of distortion. Is that to do with your equipment, or is that a particular interest?
It gives a track a lot of energy if you distort something. You know, I like tracks with energy in them, I suppose, so I suppose it's just aggressive, and I like that in music. We'll be right back.
hadn't got into music, what would you...
Well, my dad's a miner. I did a bit of work in the mines as well when I was about 17 or something. That's where I got my first money to get my first equipment, really. So it sort of helped me out for music.
What was that? What was it like?
It was so hot. It's really, really hot underground, and all the miners just walk around with like either pants on or just their belts and nothing else. They're just walking around in a nude, like really hard,
strangely primitive.
Yeah, with sort of, you know, shovels and stuff. I was well spun out.
'cause I'm not a woman. And it's the only woman that can get it.
Talk to us about this one.
It's just junglish.
You like jungle?
Yeah, only about 1% of it at the moment. It's really, really interesting.
What has that 1% got that you like?
I just get into it from the sort of anal, intricate, sort of programmed rhythms. That's why I like it. It's mainly inspired by my mate, Luke Vibert, and the sort of jungle tracks that he's been doing. That's about the first thing that's inspired me that's sort of modern for about 5 years, I think.
Thank you.
That EP of the Aphex Twins, Hangable Auto Bob, that Richard told us was actually an anagram, well, I've managed to decode it without his assistance, I hasten to add. And I'll give you a clue. What it actually involves is one of the names that he uses occasionally as an alias. If you can also decode Hangable Auto Bulb and tell us what it actually stands for, and send it on a postcard to the usual mixing it address marking your entry Aphex, the first three correct answers will win an EP.
say thanks very much to Richard James, the Aphex Twin.